Good evening. I'm Nancy Beck from the Adult School Board and its lecture committee. Welcome to the next to the last lecture in our Many Faces of Islam series. We've had more changes, rescheduling, and rearranging in this series than any of us can remember. Tonight's lecture, for instance, was originally planned for the day after we were visited by Hurricane Sandy. You remember her. But here we are tonight, ready for Michael Berry to dazzle us with Islamic art. I'm not going to tell you everything about Michael Berry's and what he's done in his fascinating and varied career, just a few highlights. Born in New York City, raised in Paris and Afghanistan. His undergraduate work was in Near Eastern Studies here at Princeton, and he took higher degrees in anthropology and Islamic studies at Cambridge University, McGill University, and his PhD from the School of Higher Studies and Social Sciences, I translated that from the original French, in Paris. He interrupted his academic career for several years to serve as an international humanitarian worker in war-torn Afghanistan until 2001, working with the International Federation for Human Rights, the UN, and Doctors Without Borders. He returned to Princeton and academic life in 2004, where his focus is on Islamic art, history, and culture. As a recognized expert in Islamic art, Professor Berry reorganized the Metropolitan Museum's Galleries of Islamic Art, which reopened in 2011. Okay. His books, articles, and catalogs are not only too numerous to mention, but the titles are way beyond my high school French, to say nothing of my Persian. So I'm going to let Michael Berry tell us what we need to know about his intriguingly titled subject, Solar Bird, Holy Fool, and Lady Beloved, Mystical Symbolism in Medieval Islamic Art. He has promised me it will be just beautiful, and he has also promised me that you're not supposed to worry when the 50 minutes are up because this is the whole show. Professor Berry.
Once upon a time, all the birds in the world, symbols of human souls, were invited by the little bird that is Solomon's messenger, a symbol of wisdom, to gather and to go forth across the universe, flying as far as they might to the distant horizon of the east, where atop a great mountain uniting earth and heaven dwells the sunbird, a wonderful bird. Who even knows what the bird looks like except for the fact that a single feather of this magic bird fell somewhere in China, and the Chinese became intoxicated with its beauty and became the most marvelous artists in the world in their memory of just one feather of this fabulous bird. And the Persians learned to paint from the Chinese, just as a matter of fact, as the Koreans and the Japanese in art history. But let's stay in the world of myth. The birds are told by the hoopoe that this wonderful bird should become their monarch. All human beings have rulers, why not the folk of the birds? And the birds, after much coaxing by the hoopoe, each bird looking for excuses, the falcon saying, I am the royal bird, why should I leave my sultan's wrist? Or the duck claiming, I live in water, why should I leave my natural element? Anyway, the hoopoe finally convinced them, and the birds flew towards the distant east to find the sunbird and to recognize her as their monarch. Only 30 birds will survive, and we will find out why. This wonderful painting is an evocation by an Indian artist of the very end of the 16th century, painted in the Persian manner, pondering upon the extraordinary imagery of probably the most beautiful Sufi Persian, mystical Persian poem in existence that we choose to call, not by the ridiculous title, Conference of the Birds, but something far more poetic, The Canticle of the Birds, by the poet Attar, who died almost in the same year as St. Francis of Assisi. He died in 1221 AD. The Canticle of the Birds reminds us that for Islamic mysticism, as for Judaic and Christian mysticism, King Solomon, he who is supposed to have composed the Song of Songs, or Canticle of the Canticles in the Roman Catholic translation, Canticum Canticorum, King Solomon is supposed to have been the recipient of all God's wisdom and his legendary messenger to all our souls, symbolized by birds, is the hoopoe. According to the medieval Persian vision of King Solomon, his great wisdom is imparted to him by a ray of light that comes from a solar burst that is equated with God. And that solar burst is configured in the symbolism of this symbol of this civilization by this wonderful sunbird. Now, we can see in a painting like this, which dates from the middle of the 16th century, and is an illustration to the poems of Nizami, and after him, Rumi, 12th and 13th centuries, and it tells the story of a king who heard that the greatest painters in the world were the Greeks and the Chinese, the Byzantine Greeks and the Chinese. Well, which is a, I'm going to try to get that right. Left-handed people, as you know, are always disadvantaged with these machines. So here we are. The Greeks over here in the West and the Chinese over here in the East. Now, the king wanted to have a contest. He heard that the great painters were... Okay, thank you. No? Go back. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Look up.
It's not on the projector. Okay, well, while this is going on, I'll just tell you the story. So the king asked his guards to prepare a room in a great palace, and the rooms were perfectly bare, the walls were perfectly blank, and in one great hall, the king ordered that they set up a great curtain, and the Greek painters would work on the western side of the curtain, and the Chinese painters would work on the eastern side of the curtain. Now, the Greeks asked for precious pigments. They asked for powdered lapis lazuli for blue. They asked for gold leaf. They asked for silver. They asked for malachite for the green. They asked for cinnabar for the red. They asked for orpiment for the yellow, and then we come back to gold.
Sorry, I think the jet is frozen. I can go see what I can do on there to fix it, but
the projector is frozen.
The jet is frozen. It's not, unfortunately, it's not a problem with the computer down here. Something up there has...
So I'll have to go on with the story.
Sorry. Yeah, I apologize. I'll see what I can do.
So to continue with the story, the Greeks asked for all this very expensive pigmentation, and they started painting their panel, their blank wall. The Chinese were asked by the ruler, "And what kind of paints would you require?" And the Chinese replied, "Oh, nothing at all, just sponges and scouring pads." the emperor was surprised, and he said, "You do realize that there's going to be a contest." "Oh yes, your majesty, we know, that's all we need." So the emperor supplied them with sponges and scouring pads, and the Chinese went to work scouring and polishing and rubbing and scrubbing until their great white wall began to sparkle. On the other side of the curtain, because neither side was supposed to see what was going on, the Greeks were painting something absolutely marvelous. And then, on the day of the contest, the emperor ordered that the curtain be raised, and lo and behold, the painting of the Greeks was perfectly reflected in the wall of the Chinese. And the emperor, and that's in the painting, which I hope you'll be able to see, but this gives you an idea of the kind of thing he saw. What you'll see in the painting is that he put his finger in his mouth and bit it, which is a sign of awe, wonderment in medieval Persian pictorial convention. What was the meaning of this story? According to the medieval Islamic philosophers and mystics, the meaning of the story was this: the Greeks represent the philosophers, the intellectuals, the rationalists, people who are capable of constructing a completely logical image of the universe through the power of their brains. And medieval Muslims were certainly highly respectful of what the Greeks had done. Medieval Islamic philosophy is predicated to a very great extent on Greek philosophy. Greeks were never referred to by medieval Muslims as Westerners or as foreigners. Greeks were always referred to as simply the ancients. All the more reason, because so many people who had written in Greek for 1,000 years had been Syrians and Egyptians to begin with. After the days of Alexander, for 1,000 years, Greek was the intellectual language of all Western Asia and much of Northeast Africa as well, Egypt in particular. So that's what the Greeks had done. And on the other side of the curtain, what had the Chinese done? Are we going to discover what the Chinese have done or not yet?
I've phoned someone to see if I can get into the projection room, but I'm going to try something else. I'm really sorry about this. This doesn't really happen.
So we'll carry on.
Yes, unfortunately. Just...
It's a good thing that we have one image. What the Chinese intended, according to the medieval Islamic explanations, was that they are the mystics. They see the same thing as the philosophers, but they see it not through the rational power of the brain, but through the perfect awareness of the heart's intuition. The idea behind the story is that the philosophers who rationalize and the mystics who have the intuition of revelation are in fact talking about the same thing, except for the idea that the philosophers are striving so hard to do it, whereas the Chinese, in their Buddhist vision, have simply mirrored the cosmic order upon their heart, perceived as a spotless receptacle for the light of the Lord. Hence, the medieval Islamic saying attributed to the Prophet Muhammad, "Seek wisdom, even if it lies in China." There is an even deeper level to this story, which is this great sunbird is supposed to rise in China. What it means is that in the medieval Islamic symbolic geography, China regarded as the home of the arts and the home of great wise people that it was good to learn from. China was regarded as lying on the side of the rising sun, whereas the Greeks dwelt on the side of the setting sun. And our own life follows this pattern. We are born as souls, as if we were sparks of light cast by the great sun that symbolizes the Lord. And our souls go through the whole course of sunlight, from the rise that is our childhood, to the zenith of our adult life, to the setting sun in the west. This kind of symbolism is not only specific to the medieval Muslims, although they highly developed this kind of spirituality. It was the idea that you find in so many civilizations, especially when people were not really aware of exactly how the sun and the earth stood in relation to one another. Traditional mythologies register the awe, the terror felt by human beings at seeing the symbol of life itself disappearing into the west and then re-emerging on the other side. What had happened to the sun? Where did the sun go? Mythologies from many cultures, ancient Babylonian, very ancient Chinese, ancient Egyptian, and ancient Mexican, describe the course of the sun as if the sun were a great, magnificent bird. This bird, which symbolizes the sun rays, always represented as a bird of prey, either an eagle or a hawk, or even sometimes, as in Egypt, a vulture, but always a bird of prey. Why a bird of prey? Because this great sunbird is conceived of as locked in permanent combat with a dragon. The dragon symbolizes this lower world of darkness. The idea is that the great eagle pounces upon the dragon and vanquishes it until, in the combat, the dragon manages to swallow the sunbird. And that is night swallowing the sun. However, comes resurrection, and the sunbird arises miraculously in the east. The dragon has been forced to disgorge the great sun, which arises. Now, we know this myth that I'm describing to you not only in various Persian and Indian, East Indian forms, or in Aztec forms. I can even give it to you in the Christian form, which is Christ the Son goes down into the night of death and hell at the crucifixion of Friday. Saturday is spent saving the souls. Sunday, the day of the sun, he arises in the resurrection of Easter. Medieval Christians constantly portrayed Christ as a burst of sunlight, symbolized by the halo. So these are constant religious images that you find here, beautifully represented with the idea that the sunbird flies high above the dragon of the lower world that you can see here. So to come back to the paintings that the emperor saw, of course he was tremendously impressed. And what the other picture will show you, what is, thanks. What the other picture will show you is that the Greek painters depicted the tree of life and all the creatures of the cosmos at the very bottom of the tree of life is a dragon, and at the very top of the tree of life is the sunbird. This the Chinese perfectly reflected upon their spotless intuitional awareness. Further, this tale is an elaborate allegory of what is supposed to have happened when a great Islamic philosopher, Avicenna, Ibn Sina, in the early 11th century, met a great dervish, mystic, Abu Sa'id ibn Abi al-Khair, given that name. Well, Abu Sa'id ibn Abi al-Khair was the kind of dervish who went wandering around screaming all sorts of things like, "Oh Lord, you have filled me so much that I could repeat, like some of my masters, I am God himself, because I do not exist. Only God exists in me." So this kind of spiritual master who would wander through the streets with a begging bowl, and the people would either throw stones at him, at a madman, as a madman, and he would say, thank you, throw stones at me, you humble me. Or some people would say, this is a holy fool, and we must give him coins so that he can find something to eat. Of course, such dervishes very much perpetuated, reproduced in the Persian Central Asian world, the Buddhist culture of Eastern Iran with its wandering monks, which morph into the dervishes of the medieval Islamic world very much. There's a tremendous Buddhist influence constantly seeping from East Asia into West Asia, camouflaged as it might appear. So this particular dervish meets Avicenna ibn Sina. I gave you the Latin form of his name on purpose. The great philosopher who taught in Central Asia, became prime minister to a king in Isfahan, Iran, wrote profound commentaries on the thought of Aristotle, wrote what was considered the medieval world's greatest compendium of medicine. His works, written in the most difficult Arabic, were translated into Latin in medieval Spain in 12th century Toledo, and served in medieval universities as the foundation for medical teaching until the very end of the 17th century. So quite a master of thought. Avicenna, the philosopher, and Abu Sa'id ibn Abi al-Khair, the dervish, meet, and everyone is astounded to see that they bow to one another. So the people are awed. And the dervish points at the philosopher and says, "What I see, he knows." But the philosopher bows and says, "Yes, but what I know, he sees." So it's interesting to see that the medieval Muslim philosophers are going to try to explain the wonderful Persian myth of the sunbird, which comes from a very, very ancient period, in terms of the philosophy of their own age, the idea that God, in his absolute remote solitude, is a luminous darkness. Yet God wished to manifest himself, or itself, or herself, beyond any differentiation. God pours forth his desire to be known, and it is a breaking forth of light. And as light rises over the darkness of the universe, the darkness becomes like the back of a mirror, and the entire universe becomes the shining mirror of the divine. As God thinks, then at once a configuration appears called by the Greek philosophers the intellect of the divine. God thinking upon God becomes a wonderful angelic figure. That is the configuration of God's thought. And God's thought is light pouring forth from the divine and bringing the whole world into visibility. The people who looked at the scriptures, at the example of the Archangel Gabriel announcing to Mary that she would be with child, or announcing to the prophet Muhammad, "Read, I do not know how to read." And yet the prophet receives the message of the Quran from the Archangel Gabriel. All this was identified by the medieval Muslim philosophers with this Greek idea of the active intellect, something in the thought of God which takes visible shape as a burst of light, which the Virgin Mary sees as the Archangel Gabriel, which the Prophet Muhammad sees as the Archangel Gabriel, but which many mystics chose to see as the wonderful sunbird of ancient Persian mythology. So this great bird is considered to symbolize, in the mystical poems that we're discussing now, the active intellect of God itself, shining upon our minds and giving our minds the capacity for thought. This is the mystery of the Canticle of the Birds. Birds symbolize souls. Why? Because our souls, when infused with this light, can fly high above our earthly condition and consider abstractions, ethics, fine ideas, art, poetry, music. All this defines the soul, which takes wing. This is why the hoopoe, the little hoopoe that is Solomon's messenger, invites the birds of the world to fly forth towards the east and recover a full vision of this wonderful sunbird that represents the divine shining upon our souls. Well, since we're not getting any pictures, I'm going to have to do this with words, strangely, unless we're saved. How's it going up there?
She went out there.
Okay. How's it happening?
I'm sorry. I think someone will get back to me, but yeah.
So far, you have not been able to reach anyone.
Have you rebooted the PC?
Sorry?
Have you rebooted the PC?
Anyway, fortunately we have this one fabulous image. It's gone. Now I really have to appeal to your imagination. The little hoopoe is going to tell all sorts of wonderful stories to the various birds to encourage them on their journey. And because the poet Attar, turn of the 13th century, very much belonged to the civilization of the Thousand and One Nights, the little hoopoe is in fact a Scheherazade. She tells stories that are vehicles of spiritual initiation, allowing every soul bird to learn something through a tale, to be able to take wing, to escape from this earthly condition, to try to reach the great sunbird way in the distant east. And the hoopoe will actually tell stories of human beings. which would not surprise anybody. It's the animal fable genre. We know that this particular way of telling stories was invented in ancient India as a means devised by the Brahmins to instruct the children of princes in an entertaining way with all the wisdom they would need when they would become rulers. And one of the techniques was known as, within a story, you open another story, and within that story, you open yet another story. It's known as boxed stories, in box. One box holds another box, holds another box, with the idea that even when you finish one story, there's still a frame story around that that hasn't been finished yet, and even when you finish that one, there's still another frame story around that one, and you keep on telling stories like that until you can reach the magic number of 1001, which is an Indian number which means infinity. It's an indication of infinity. This master craft of the great poets in Sanskrit was considered a model by the Persians of the 5th and 6th centuries AD, before the Islamic era, and these tales began to be translated from the Sanskrit into the Persian. When Iran became Muslim after the Arab conquest in, well, pretty much done by 651 AD, the Iranians, as they were converting, you want to?
Yeah.
You want to try it one more time? There it is, Canticle of the Birds. Now, is this going to work? Yes, it does. You can actually see the little arrow. So what you see here is the king biting on his finger here in amazement because he can't tell the difference between what the Chinese have painted and what the Greeks have painted. And this is the cosmic vision. So you see the dragon below. Every leaf represents another creature. And at the very top, you have the sunbird. So it's the constant clash between sunbird above, dragon below. So we talked about an image from Rumi, one of the great 13th century Islamic poets. And look at this. This is a 16th century frontispiece to the poetry of Rumi, where we see the king watching the dervishes, the mystics, dance to imitate the circling of the spheres until they fall into mystical ecstasy. And on the left here, we have Rumi himself weeping as he holds the book of his poetry. Why does he weep? Because he says in the first verses of his poem, "Listen to the song of the reed flute, how it weeps, because as a reed it was torn from the reed bed to be made into a flute, and yet ever since it has become a flute, and it weeps, men and women dance and weep, listening to it." So he's regarded as the weeping poet, and he sits under a wonderful tree, which is in multicolored leaf foliage, because this corresponds to the tree of life, of which the mystics say, when the tree of the cosmos, because the entire universe may be compared to a tree, beheld the perfect saint who mirrored all the cosmos in his meditation, the great tree trembled with joy in the multiplicity of its colors. The tree grows from the river of life. As the poet contemplates this lower world where we are like chess pieces, alternating between night and day, and the players play with our destiny. There is only one creature in this whole painting that does not understand what is going on. It is the withered bush here, which symbolizes those branches of the tree of life that no longer receive the nourishment of the divine sap, the water of life, of mystical understanding. They are withered and dry. This particular painting, which we knew represented Rumi, allowed this marvelous identification. This is a detail of a painting in the Metropolitan Museum of Art that was painted in Herat, Afghanistan, in 1490, showing various mystical figures. And now we can recognize that the mystical figure who is shown hiding his face and weeping is necessarily Rumi, Rumi the weeping poet. You can admire the fact that the original is no bigger than a playing card. This is only a single detail. That means that, say, this face is no bigger than half the fingernail on your pinky. How could these late 15th century painters work in such extraordinary detail before the magnifying glass? They used a bottle full of water and they placed it on the page and they used the bottle of water as their magnifying glass. That's all they had. This is the complete painting showing the great dervish dance, and in our coming publication in English, we show how this is the Turkish translator of Attar. This is the poet Cami, who is the greatest mystical teacher of the 15th century, bowing to one another as the dance begins. This represents older poets. Here we recognize Rumi. Here we recognize the poet Hafez, because his kaftan is pink, meaning it is tinged with the blood of his heart, which is mystically compared to wine. So it is the kaftan, rose-colored, dipped in wine. And here, probably, most probably, is the poet of the Canticle of the Birds, Attar. So, translated from Persian to Turkish in the 15th century by Navai, and there they contemplate the dervish dance. The details. This is how we recognize the Turkish translator, who was the minister of the kingdom of Herat, Navai, from another painting. We can compare, and thus we find who this is. Here he is. Here is Cami, the musicians, the dancers. Closer, closer. Wonderful fainting dervish. This had to be done by a master so great, Behzad, the leading artist of the kingdom of Herat in the 1490s, 1480s and 1490s, and this is why he was entrusted with illustrating one of the most important Sufi poems of all, the Canticle of the Birds, as we shall see. So there they are. Poets of the Soul, Attar, Cami, Navai, Attar, the Canticle of the Birds, and 2.5 centuries later, the two great mystics, Cami and Navai, who in the kingdom of Herat urged the king to commission a fresh manuscript of the poetry of Attar. And this is an absolutely new discovery from the great manuscript of the works of Attar. This is a painting added in the early 17th century, and we recognize here Navai, the Turkish translator from the late 15th century, and here the poet Attar himself. And this is exactly the salutation we've been talking about on either side of the tree of life. What I know, he sees, yes, but what I see, he knows, back and forth. So this marvelous manuscript was discovered in 1963. It resurfaced after having disappeared for more than 200 years. It was painted in the city of Herat in 1486-1487. It was bequeathed by the kings of Herat to their successors, the kings of Iran, and in Isfahan in the year 1609. It was completed with fresh paintings, given this new and marvelous binding, and thereafter preserved in the great shrine of the imperial Iranian family of the Safavids, where all their kings were buried, so that scholars could come and consult this wonderful manuscript. Yet, in 1722, northern Iran was invaded by a Russian army, and in the pillaging of the great shrine of Ardabil, the manuscript disappeared and resurfaced in 1963. In Afghanistan, and its Afghan owner sold it to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, where it is now. Here's an example of the wonderful pages of this manuscript, 15th century calligraphy, and the marbled paper margins added in the early 17th century. Another wonderful page of what this civilization calls suspended cursive. The two kings most associated with this wonderful book, on the left, the Sultan of Herat in what is now Afghanistan, Sultan Hussein, who commissioned the manuscript in 1486-1487, and on the right, the king in Isfahan, Iran, Shah Abbas the Great, who had the manuscript completed and placed in the imperial shrine. These are the two artists. Behzad on the left painted the Sultan on the left, and Bishindas, an Indian, a Hindu in fact, was a member of an Indian embassy to the Shah in Isfahan, painted the Shah using his wonderfully mixed Indo-Persian technique in 1609. And here are the three places associated with the great manuscript. Herat in the upper left, the great castle, what's left of its decoration. This is where the manuscript was begun in 1486-1487. It was completed in the Iranian city of Isfahan in 1609 and deposited in the great shrine of northern Iran, Ardabil, where the Iranian kings were buried. This is the Westminster Abbey of the Safavid dynasty. Now, the question is always asked, how could these sacred books, considered charged with mystical wisdom in Islamic civilization, be illustrated with pictures of human beings, birds, and animals? Isn't all that supposed to be forbidden? That's the endless question, constantly raised. And the answer is provided by this painting done by Master Behzad in Herat 1 year after he finished the poem of Attar, the Canticle of the Birds. This painting alone is the Rosetta Stone of Islamic art. It depicts a story that many of you know from the Bible. Once upon a time, Joseph was sold as a slave in Egypt by his jealous brethren. And in Egypt, he was put into the service of a powerful Egyptian lady, the wife of one of Pharaoh's ministers. And the lady lusted after her slave, and she tore at his tunic. He tore himself away from her embrace yet she accused him before the husband, and Joseph, as we know, was cast in prison, and after many adventures, will eventually become prime minister of the Pharaoh himself. Now, this story was interpreted in later Jewish times in Alexandria in the 2nd or 3rd century AD in Greek, a Jew writing in Greek in Alexandria, as a metaphor for the love of the soul, meaning the Lady of Egypt, for a manifestation of the divine mirrored upon the countenance of a prophet, Joseph. She fell in love without realizing that what impelled her was not simply lust, but a stirring of an idea that there was something lying beyond. So she was attracted to Joseph. According to this 2nd or 3rd century AD Judeo-Greek romance, when Joseph became prime minister of Egypt, the lady by then had fallen into misery and despair and old age, and she was a wandering beggar in the streets when Joseph rode by on his magnificent chariot, and she called out to him, "Do you remember me?" He looked upon her, and her beauty was instantly restored, and they married and lived happily ever after. An interesting take on the biblical story, which seems to have entered into the mainstream of Islamic civilization. And in the kingdom of Herat, the story is told in the choice Persian of Jami in the late 15th century. And we know that the story symbolizes the yearning of the soul for the mirror of the divine. Behzad, the great artist of the kingdom, was asked to illustrate the story as told by an earlier 13th century poet, Sa'di. But this manuscript was presented to the king of Herat, and what Behzad added were other verses by the leading Muslim scholar of the kingdom, Jami, who had just told this story in a new version. And Jami's verses say, "This wonderful palace wrought for the lady by a magician artist was so marvelous because this magician artist, if he but drew the picture of a bird upon a stone and blew on it, he would give it life." And we understand that these verses are a reference to Behzad himself. What does that story mean? It is one of the stories that Islam associates with Jesus Christ. According to the Quran and to certain so-called apocryphal gospels, like the Pseudo-Thomas or the Pseudo-Matthew, once upon a time, the child Jesus molded birds of clay, blew upon them, and gave them life. Of course, a symbol for Jesus who resurrects the dead, because the bird is a symbol of the soul. When the Quran tells this story, which I find here illustrated in a 12th century Swiss church, one of the few representations in Christian art, when the Quran tells the story, it emphasizes the words of God, "with my permission, bi-ithni." What this meant was that the poet, who is at the same time the leading theologian of the kingdom of Herat, is saying that the painter Behzad is like the Jesus Christ of the Quran. He can mold the figure of a bird and give it life. "With my permission," said the Lord. Why? Because a painter like Behzad, instead of directing our eyes away from the work of God, as do idolaters, directs our view towards God, because the painter himself is a spotless mirror. Because he has purified his heart, he has become a true Sufi. This is why Nizad was called upon by the king to illustrate the most wonderful Sufi poem known. More pictures of Bizad. This is a very, very exciting discovery I've made recently. It shows the great mosque of Herat, painted in 1488. A beggar asks admittance. He is at first denied admittance by the gatekeeper, and yet the beggar, who is a dervish, can quote scripture, and he says, "Knock, and it shall be opened unto you." Man daqqal bab fan fataha lahu. Direct Arabic mirroring of the words of the gospel. One more indication of how many connections there truly are between Christianity and Islam, especially at the mystical level. And here we have one character whose name we've just been able to make out on his notebook, and it is the self-portrait of Bizad, the painter himself. Now, Bizad, chosen to illustrate the stories told by the hoopoe to the birds. She is a Scheherazade, and she tells them tales to initiate their souls. This particular tale by Attar in the storybook shows just how Bizad, in the late 15th century, meditates on a Sufi poem of the early 13th century. Once upon a time, there was a certain mullah, an Orthodox Muslim cleric, who was so proud of his long beard. Just like that, five fingers worth. You have to have that. Every Taliban will tell you that. You have to have a beard this long. And he looked at himself in the mirror, and he would comb his beard, and he would stroke his beard, and he would shampoo his beard, and he was in love with his beard, and he kept on looking at himself in a little mirror, stroking his beard, and he tripped over a stone, and he fell into a river. And he couldn't swim, and he screamed for help, 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 and here is a bystander who doesn't know how to swim either, but is telling him, you can make it back to the shore if you'll just unhook that heavy sack that you have that's hanging from your ears. And the mullah says, well, it isn't a sack, it's my beard. Well, I'm sorry. And the beard drags the mullah down to the bottom of the river. Of course, a warning by the poet against the Orthodox types who are so obsessed with the minutiae of external details that they forget the true meaning of the faith. Now, in this painting, the bystander here stands between the tree of life and the withered tree. Sap, living, dead souls. Yet below we have this strange scene, which is not in the poem. This is Bizad's own comment on the poem. Now let's see what he's trying to say. Here's the scene of the mullah drowning. Okay, that we know. We have here the seal of Shah Abbas. We have here the great inscription meaning Waqf. This is a manuscript dedicated to a shrine. All this we expect. But why this character? Why a woodcutter? Is Bizad just having fun? Is this just a genre scene? No. The poet himself, Attar, sitting on a stone here, is pointing down, telling us, look carefully and you will understand the meaning. The meaning is that Bizad quotes from Rumi, later 13th century, to offer comment upon the poetry of Attar, early 13th century. And this is a standard trick of Persian civilization. These painters are highly literate. They expect those who are privileged enough to contemplate such manuscripts to know at least the 8 or 9 absolutely mandatory classical Persian poets from Ferdowsi to Jami. Therefore, they can quote visually from one poet to throw light upon the meaning of another. And this actually is an illustration of a story by Rumi, which says, once upon a time, there was a caliph, very pious caliph, and yet this caliph overslept to the point that he was about to miss morning prayers. Suddenly he heard a stirring in the curtains in his bedchamber, and appeared before him a character who said, wake up, it's time for your morning prayers. And the caliph says, well, thank you very much for waking me up, but how did you get into my bedchamber? It's absolutely forbidden. And the character said, well, easy, I am the devil. The devil? How the devil did you get into my bedchamber? And why are you, of all creatures, waking me up to go to dawn prayers, which is a meritorious act? And the devil tells all sorts of stories, and the caliph shakes him and says, I want to know the truth, I want to know the truth. And the devil whines and says, why does everybody blame me for what goes on earth? Don't people realize that I am God's servant? I am his woodcutter. And God has charged me to go through the forest of this earth. And whenever I see a tree that is devoid of sap, it may be upright, but I know that it is spiritually dead. I cut it, and I load the firewood for the eternal fire. Okay, says the caliph, now I know who you are and what you are for. What I really want to know is, why did you wake me up? And the devil says, well, to tell you the truth, if you had overslept, you would have wept such tears of repentance and humility that your self-humiliation would have been far more agreeable to God than the arrogance you have of carrying out your daily prayers. The ultimate trick of the devil. And so here, Behzad has represented the devil himself with the earring signifying his badge of service, Al-Qabagush. He is a servant of God. Nevertheless, he is the devil, blasted, dark, and he overlooks his workers who are carrying the dead branches. Just as in the Gospels it is written, I have come with an axe against all those trees that are not capable of bearing fruit. It's a terrible message, and it is a parable which reoccurs throughout both spiritual traditions. So this is Behzad's way of saying the mullah who allowed his long beard to drag him down to perdition can be compared to these souls which seem upright and yet are like dead trees, no longer nourished by the sap of meaning. Here is one of the strangest paintings by Behzad. It's from the same manuscript. And of course, the oddest thing is the Buddhist worthy monk sleeping here. This now painted in 1486-1487. And here, the actual illustration occurs below. This is Behzad's trick of dividing the painting into a kind of inclined plane, separating the actual subject and the painter's commentary. Here the subject is below, and the commentary is above. What is happening below? Well, that famous mystic that we had referred to, who bowed to the philosopher, Abu Sa'id ibn Abi Khair, one day went off into the desert, here he is, in a great funk, seized by a terrible depression. he could no longer bear to wait for the meaning of why does God take so long? Why should Judgment Day retreat like the horizon and never come? How long must we wait, O Lord, how long? And he sees a peasant in the field with his oxen, and the peasant says to the great mystical master, "You seem very depressed, my lord. What's the matter?" And the master explains, and the peasant instructs the master. And the peasant says, "You know, my lord, I have heard that there was once upon a time a great mountain higher than all the world, a great mountain of rock. And once every 100 years, a little bird comes and rubs its beak on the summit of that mountain. When that entire mountain will have disappeared, an instant of eternity will have elapsed. That is the meaning of patience, my lord." It's a very interesting Buddhist story, which reappears like this in Eastern Islamic literature. One more indication of what we should not forget, that all the Eastern Iranian lands that correspond today to easternmost Iran, Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, all these areas before they were Muslim had in fact been Buddhist. So the Greek, the Judaic, the Christian is not the only influence that is absorbed into Islamic culture. The ancient Persian is, of course, and also streams that come from the Indian and Buddhist world. So is this the reason that Behzad included a Buddhist figure above? Well, let's see how this actually worked out. Here is this Buddhist figure sleeping. We know that by the end of the 15th century, this area had not been Buddhist for 1,000 years. Why include a Buddhist figure? What did Behzad associate with Buddhism? Chinese merchants came to the kingdom of Herat. It was one of the great stops of the famous Silk Route. So there were plenty of Chinese merchants, much Chinese art, highly appreciated by the kings of Herat. But why include a Buddhist figure right in the middle of a Sufi story? Behzad himself could not have known that the tale told by the peasant was ultimately of Buddhist origin. It had already been absorbed into Islamic culture for far too long for him to know. What gives away the meaning of this strange Buddhist character is the dog on a leash. Now, what can that possibly mean? Well, this is one of the Chinese models that was used by Islamic painters of the 15th century of Buddhist monks. Here, three very jolly Buddhist monks. We know that this particular Ming Chinese 15th century painting was part of the great collections in Tabriz, Persia, in the middle of the 15th century. We know it because this painting is now in Istanbul, where it was taken from Tabriz in 1512. So we know that this was the kind of picture that these Central Asian and Iranian artists were looking at. But look how it was interpreted by a Muslim artist of around 1480, Sheikhi. He has shown three Buddhist worthies asleep. One Buddhist worthy points at a tame tiger, meaning our lower bestial nature has been tamed, yet our souls, like a bird, look above. So there's a Sufi twist to this adaptation of a Chinese painting and the comments of the painter below. And now watch. The same painter, the same one, Sheikhi, adapted this Chinese model to represent a Christian story which is very much included in the Quran and meditated upon by Muslims. It is the story of the seven sleepers of Ephesus. Ephesus in modern Turkey, ancient Asia Minor. Once upon a time, there was a pagan persecution, and seven faithful Christians with their tame dog escaped the persecution by entering a cave, and God in his mercy caused the mouth of the cave completely to be covered up so that the pagan pursuers could not see the Christian faithful hiding inside, and the Christian faithful and their dog were put to sleep by God for hundreds of years. When they awoke and made their way out of the cave with their dog, they discovered a world which had become converted to Christianity. This is the story of the seven sleepers of the cave of Ephesus, which by the 6th century AD had become one of the most important shrines in Eastern Christendom in the Byzantine Empire, and as such known to Syrians, to Egyptians, and it is therefore included in the Quran and meditated, because it's one of the sermons that are repeated every Friday for Friday prayers. The story of the seven sleepers and their dog is interpreted by Sufis as a symbol of our worthy souls waiting in the cave of the other world until the day of the resurrection. This is why this model is constantly repeated all the way into late 16th, early 17th century Islamic Persian art. There's the tame dog, even has a name, Kitmir. The dog is interpreted as our dog-like flesh, which finally is domesticated and tamed by our souls resting in the other world until the resurrection. This is why Behzad simply took one of these figures to signify them all. And that is why, if you go up, you can see that he has the dog on a leash. So what the whole painting symbolizes is the comment on the question. We sleep like the worthy who has become one of the seven sleepers, awaiting the resurrection when all souls will be weighed like these fruit, some to disappear into the bag because they are withered like the dry tree, unlike the tree of life under which the worthy sleeps. Now, further, to understand the depth of this art, when Behzad painted in 1486, 1487, he didn't just emerge out of nowhere. There had been a very long tradition in the kingdom of Herat in particular, also in Tabriz, in modern northwestern Iran, of depicting the most profound spiritual truths through art. This early 15th century painting from Herat shows much of the mystery of Islamic art. It shows the creation by God of Adam. Adam described by the Quran as God's viceroy on earth. So he's presented in royal clothing with a royal crown. And God commanded the angels to bow down and worship him. Only one angel refused, saying, "You created him of mud. You created me of fire. You ordered us to worship you alone. Why should I bow down before your creature?" And God said, "I know what you know not. You have become arrogant, and I cast you out of heaven. Go and lead souls astray." This is the devil, identified here, Shaitan Laim, pulling on his beard, showing with perplexity this strange scene. Why is he so perplexed? Because in Islamic mysticism, the idea is the human figure is God made visible insofar as God thinks the universe appears. But the universe has no mind. The universe is incapable of conceiving the abstraction that is God. Therefore, God created prototypical human being, because human being, which is what Adam means, is capable of thinking God. And because human being thinks God, human being is not only God's viceroy, human being is God's mirror, the concentrated mirror, the mirror of the rays of God's thought that are reflected back upon God. And even though God is invisible, the human mind mirrors visibly the invisible God. This the angels understand and bow down. This the tree of life understands and bows down. And only the devil, who thinks that creation is something other than God, fails to understand. To see how bold Islamic painting can get, completely overturning our preconceptions, you get this version of the same story done in the middle of the 16th century, where Adam appears with Eve, viceroy, vicereine. That means the human figure that mirrors the divine can be male or female, and they are complete when wedded, like Adam and Eve or Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. The angels bow down. Only one figure fails to understand, pulling on his beard in great perplexity and identified by the inscription, Satan the Accursed, caricatured as an orthodox mullah who cannot understand the meaning of divine manifestation as an image. So now you should be able to make sense as experts of the frontispiece to Attar's poem. When the manuscript was given to the Sultan of Herat in 1487, four pages had been left blank to receive further paintings, and they were actually only finally added on more than 100 years later in 1609 in Isfahan. And this is one of those very important pictures, and it represents all the birds of the world gathering around Solomon's messenger, the hoopoe, and you can already recognize that the tree of life itself bows in homage, in tribute to the little hoopoe, the messenger of wisdom. The detail makes that quite clear. The hoopoe here, with its little crown, stands on its rock, preaching to all the world's birds, and the tree bows as it grows from the water of life. There's the hoopoe preaching to the birds. Here are the ducks, and the ducks offer their excuse. We can't possibly embark on this great search because our element is water, and we're constantly ducking our heads in water. And this is Attar the poet's sly allusion to those Muslims who are so obsessed with ritual purity. Do I have my wuzu? Do I have my ablutions? Have I broken my ablutions? Think about your God instead of constantly thinking about the water basin in which you perform your ablutions. So there's a great element of satire in these mystical poems, and the painter himself has signed his name very humbly on the rock. Raqamahu Habibullah, painted this Habibullah of Mashhad. Here's another detail, the great falcon here, so proud, I belong on my sultan's wrist, and he is called to fly towards an even greater monarch, along with the phoenix here. Now, if you look very carefully at the stones, you will see that this stone has a nose and eyes and a mouth and horns. See it? Why? Because one of the names of the devil in Arabic is Sakhr, which means the stone. Once upon a time, the great Solomon, in his arrogance, forgot that all his power came from God. So God allowed the devil to steal Solomon's ring, which was the ring of his power, and wear it and impersonate Solomon and spread black magic throughout the world for 40 days until Solomon repented, recovered his throne and ring, and shut the evil demon forever in the rock in which he belonged. If you see in a Persian painting the face of a demon in a rock, it means that Solomonic wisdom is triumphant and the devil is locked up in stone. The devil appears here again as the hunter. And since he's also biting on his finger because he can't understand what's going on, he only sees the back of the hoopoe. He cannot see its countenance. And he is allegorized as a hunter and the 17th century painter as the kind of matchlock which was coming into use, brought to Iran by Portuguese traders in the Gulf. And you can see that this diabolic character is associated with caricatures of the rock demon. See the nose, the mouth, or here again, a mouth, no eyes. The devil is spiritually blind. Now, this is the very earliest mystical Persian painting that I've ever been able to find. It comes from Konya, the city where Rumi settled. It dates from the 13th century. And it shows the whole cosmology that we're talking about, which is, in the most distant east, there is a great mountain which unites the lower world and the sky. It is the link between earth and heaven. Around the great ocean, here appears the rock. Here is the source of life. Here is Hell City, the city of this lower world. But if you are considered worthy, you can climb this mountain with the cosmic tree, and you will find that the name of the mountain is Caucasus, Kuhikov. That's what that word means. And here, the inscription says, Oshyanaye Simor, meaning the nest of the sunbird. Here are the two little chicks of a sunbird. And this is the gate of heaven. And you go to heaven if you have reached the top. Surate osmoni dunya inast. The picture of the sky of the world or the cosmos is this. And you can compare it in Christianity to the vision of Dante. Dante, painted here in the mid-15th century, addresses the earthly city, his native Florence, warning Florence of the fate of hell. In Hell Castle, but beyond the Sea of Reeds, the mystical crossing of the Red Sea, rises the cosmic mountain associated by the Catholic poet with purgatory, where our sins are purged through seven levels until we reach the summit, which is the earthly paradise, the Garden of Eden, from which we have fallen. And if we go beyond, we move up through the spheres to the very throne of God. Now the vision of Simur, which is the name of the sunbird in Persian, upon the cosmic mountain, Mount Kaf, which actually represents a medieval Islamic pronunciation of the Greek word for the Caucasus, Kafkasus. That's where it comes from. But it came to mean the cosmic mountain. This is the wonder bird, painted by a Persian artist in the middle of the 15th century. Of course, by then, the Persians conceived of this wonderful Simur as a Chinese Fenghuang, as a Chinese sunbird, phoenix, symbol of the sun, which the Persians discovered on many vases and scrolls, which were brought by the caravans, and which they adopted as the most fitting depiction of the wonderful mythical bird. Here seen with one of its chicks, which is an indication of what we're doing in our translations. Often, the Simur is translated into English as if it were a he. That's because Orientalists and academics now rarely go into barnyards But when you do see birds that lay eggs and have chicks, they don't have And in fact, the bird is a female, which is an interesting idea that the configuration of the divine can be a female force. And how female she is, we know from the most ancient Persian form of her name, Sayena Meriha, really old Persian, 6th century BC Persian. And in that Persian, Sayena Meriha, eagle bird, is a feminine form. Of course, she is a bird of prey. According to ancient Persian mythology, here, painted by an artist in the service of a Mongol ruler of Iran who converted to Islam in the early 14th century, and you can see tremendous Chinese influence, once upon a time, a child was born to royal parents, and the royal parents were horrified because the child was an albino. So they left the child out in the desert to die of exposure. But the great sunbird took pity on the child and flew down and carried up the child to her nest and her chicks right by the summit of a cosmic mountain uniting earth and heaven. In the nest, the child learned Mantekoteir, the language of the birds. The child thought he was a bird himself. He was fed, he was nourished, he was protected by the wonderful sunbird. This is a symbol of our souls in the higher world, in the bosom, as it were, of the divine active intellect. The child, Zal, does not even know that he is a human being. However, as in this early 16th century Iranian painting, the king repented of having abandoned his child and set forth on a great journey to find him again. He went back into the desert and lifted his eyes and saw his child safe in the nest of the great Simur. And he begs the Simur to return with the child. In this mid-15th century Persian version from the kingdom of Herat, the bird has forced the child into her claws and tells the child that weeps and screams, you must return to the world of men. You must return to your father. You must become a prince, and ultimately you will be king. This is your responsibility. All this a symbol of birth. We remember our condition as soul birds, and yet we must come down into this lower world and carry out what is dictated by our destiny. The wonderful detail thereof, and in this early 16th century Iranian painting, we see the child who is now grown up. He is the king Zal, and he rules, and his foster mother has promised him, if you ever have a problem, I have given you one feather. Burn it, and when the smoke arises to heaven, I will return and I will protect you. And so he rules under a great banner which depicts his foster mother, because she symbolizes the divine intelligence radiating down on his human mind. That's the ultimate symbol in the world of Dante. And 13th and 14th century Christian mysticism, you have the same idea. L'amorosa Madonna intelligenza che fa nell'alma la sua residenza che con la sua beltà m'innamorate. My lovely lady intelligenza, who makes in the soul her residence, with her beauty she has caused me to fall in love. Love for the divine wisdom. In 16th century Iranian art, you get constant references, even in the clouds of the sky, to the eternal victory of the sunbird, you see her, over the dragon. Even sultans, like this scimitar of the Ottoman Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent, mid-16th century, as a protective talisman, depicts the combat, the victory of the sunbird over the dragon. The sunbird can be a terrible bird. It guards the approaches to the other world. Those of us who are not worthy of the sunbird will be devoured by it. It is there, the simur adam har, the simur which devours human people. Only those who are worthy to be saved, like the sailor who was shipwrecked in the middle of the Indian Ocean and was able to hang on to the claws of the great bird while it devoured his companions, was carried to the summit of the cosmic mountain and was saved. This story reappears in the popular 14th century Egyptian Thousand and One Nights. It's one of the Sinbad the Sailor stories. The prototype goes back again to an Indian tale, and this was illustrated by a Hindu artist, Basavan, for the Mughal Emperor Akbar in the late 16th century, and it illustrates a story by an Indian poet writing in Persian in the early 14th century, Amir Khosrow. So the detail, this bird can be terrifying as well as kind. In this version by the Persian poet Nizami and illustrated by Mukund, a Hindu artist in the very last years of the 16th century in India, we see the bird carrying the symbol of the soul from the top of the tower, which symbolizes the link between earth and heaven, to paradise itself. Then it will return the soul to this lower world where we all wear the black of mourning because we remember the paradise that we have lost. The bird, therefore, is a symbol of our intellect illuminated by divine thought, which can carry us up to heaven, since the human mind can look up at the stars and even conceive of the divine. So the human mind does rise high above this lower world, and this is configured as the active intellect, the sunbird, carrying us up, like here the philosopher Socrates, depicted as a 16th century Muslim scholar, carried up to the highest heaven by the sunbird. Ancient prototypes. Bear with me, thanks, since you know we did have a problem. We see the sunbird in some of the most ancient Persian art. This dates from about 500 BC, so more than 1,000 years before the Islamic age, from Susa. And the great sunbird here, the sun, winged, because the sun flies high over our heads and is therefore configured as a marvelous bird, and the sun illuminates the world the way intelligence illuminates our minds. So they're all equated. But this soul, this wonderful solar system, is guarded from the unworthy by these twin monsters. The twin monsters are twin because they serve a twin function. Unto those who are unworthy, approach is forbidden. To those who are worthy, approach is allowed. The guardian dragon or monster is therefore often dual in heraldry to symbolize this very profound mystical idea. The sunbird of the Persians, of course, in art, is derived from the sunbird of the Egyptians, since the Persian Empire embraced the entire ancient Near East from Egypt to the frontiers of India. We see the sunbird with its guardian snakes here flying over Pharaoh, illuminating Pharaoh's mind. Pharaoh further guarded by two further embodiments of the sunbird, the hawk and the vulture, with the cross of life in each case. Or here, the sunbird as Horus, the hawk, carrying the sun as a crown beneath the arc of the sky, and yet it is surrounded by the great serpent that symbolizes the ocean that surrounds our lower world. Horus, again, with the sun symbol, he is a bird, he is also a god with a human shape and holds the cross of life. And the idea that the soul also may be depicted as a bird is found in so much ancient Egyptian art, where here the queen, Nefertari, prays, and behind her is a depiction of her ka, her own soul, which will fly up to join the sun, ultimately. Plato has the story, the Aztecs have the story, it's a universal symbol, the soul as a bird. As here, for example, where the soul clearly flies above the sarcophagus towards immortality. The sunbird in ancient Egypt, from one of the most ancient Egyptian depictions we have, the triumph of a falcon over the snake. This is from about 2400 BC, and from very late Egyptian civilization, at the very end of the Roman period, just before the conversion of Egypt to Christianity in the 4th century AD, we have the depiction of Horus, the sun god, as a Roman general, but wearing, of course, his falcon head, and his lance, symbolizing a sun ray, pierces the terrible reptile. Of course, we're in Egypt, so it's a crocodile now. This is one of the prototypes of the composite creature which in the 4th century came to be revered as Christianity became triumphant, as Saint George victorious over the dragon. One excursus to ancient America, you all know the Mexican symbol. The Aztec people settled where they saw the great sunbird fly down upon a serpent, writhing upon a cactus, and devour the serpent right by the shore of the lake where the Aztecs chose to raise their capital. It is truly a universal symbol of the sun as a predatory and yet protective bird. Back to ancient Persia, just before the Islamic conquest of Persia in the 7th century AD, depictions of the sunbird were beginning to be a little clumsy. They didn't quite know how to render this wonderful creature, and so you get pictures like this of what they now call the sin mor, or sin morph. But the influence of the Chinese, most powerful in the 13th and 14th centuries, flooded the Persian lands with depictions of the Chinese phoenix, which is also a sunbird, and this is the model that was adopted by Islamic artists after the turn of the 14th century. Here are two sunbirds protecting the pearl of life, eternal life. And those are the little chicks we saw of the wonderful female sunbird. Now, the poem is about the illumination of the soul of Solomon himself. In this late 16th century Persian depiction, we get the idea that the archetypical human couple are Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. Because they are intelligent, a ray surrounds them, and it comes from the sunbird, which is the configuration of the divine active intellect above Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. Solomon understands even the language of the birds. He also understands the languages of all animals. He has dominated his beastly impulses because he is a wise man. He has angelic qualities. So he is represented as the cosmic ruler with the Queen of Sheba by his side. Their minister, Asaph, recognizes that this is the true Solomon and not a demonic impersonator, with his queen upon the throne that rests upon the crushed dragon directly below the sunbird. And here you have the various demons symbolizing our lower impulses that have learned to serve Solomon also. And since this is a very nasty Islamic picture, it is also a caricature of the Hindu gods, representing his demons, Ganesh, the elephant-headed god. The detail thereof. This is an Indian version from the turn of the 16th and 17th centuries. Solomon with his little hoopoe here, and the sunbird is there. And the Indians by the late 16th century are showing much European influence with the Portuguese embassies delivering these Renaissance lessons in wonderful shading for the elephant and the rhinoceroses. Solomon again, his hoopoe. Hoopoe introduces a dervish, and you have the wonderful sunbird, 16th century India. Or here, this 16th century Indian painting is most interesting because it shows the exact symbolism intended. Once upon a time, there was a judge. This judge was about to sentence an innocent man to death. It was represented to the judge by this intervener that the man was actually innocent, so the judge will forgive him. The judge is therefore inspired by Solomon, who rules over the genie, represented here in an adaptation of a European Baroque picture, and the Archangel Gabriel inspires Solomon because the Archangel Gabriel is an equivalent configuration of the sunbird. And this was actually taken from another painting and glued onto this painting and makes the symbolism very clear. This is another Indian painting, the detail of which we saw from the very end of the 16th century, showing the cosmic mountain. Here, the crow addresses all the animals of the world, and the cosmic bird flies in eternal triumph over the dragon. Even the Hindus in late 16th century India realized what was in fact the case, that the Persian sunbird is cognate and originates in the same mythological figure that is called in ancient India Garuda, the winged creature that is truly an eagle that carries Vishnu. And the symbolism is fundamentally the same, which is why in the late 16th century, when Persian and Indian influences combined in the very syncretic civilization of the Mughal Empire, Hindu artists adapted from the Persians depictions of the Simur as their own Garuda carrying Vishnu triumphant over the demons. We can't leave the storybook without centering on its fundamental message, which is one of love. Of course, the Sufis are profoundly influenced by Plato, one of the greatest of all Sufis. Ibn Arabi of Spain was called in the early 13th century Ibn Aflatun, son of Plato. So Neoplatonic love pervades these stories. These are two illustrations from a story that was very popular in the late 14th and early 15th centuries in the Persian world, and yet the painter also refers to the storybook of Attar. Once upon a time, there was a Syrian prince who dreamt that he was carried by night into a wonderful garden in China, and he beheld the Empress of China. He fell deeply in love with her, but was told by her, "You must return to the everyday waking world. She is guarded by her twin servants that represent the transcendence and immanence of the divine." Transcendence: the divine is above all things. Immanence: the divine is in all things. You must go between the two to be united with the beloved, who is the configuration of divine thought as a beautiful woman. The prince, when he awakes, decides to leave Syria, which to the Persian poet meant the west, the side where the sun sets, towards China, the side where the sun rises, and finally beheld the princess on her balcony, and she is considered to be an equivalent symbol to the sun bird, which is why all the soul birds are flying towards her also. Tales of Humayun, Humayun. This is the most extraordinary story told by the poet Attar in the Canticle of the Birds. It is scarcely believable that a late 12th, early 13th century Muslim poet could have told such a story, and that 15th and 16th century Muslim painters should have illustrated it for 15th and 16th century Muslim kings, both Sunni and Shi'i. It tells the story of a certain Orthodox mullah in Arabia who was famous for his strict regard for the rules, upholding the absolute invisible transcendence of God as he prayed in Mecca, surrounded by disciples who kissed his hand and revered his every word, until one night the sheikh heard the word of God saying, "Shame upon you for your arrogance. Instead of bragging about what a great Muslim you are, I want you to go to the city of the Christians. Go to Constantinople, go to Byzantium, and there, among the Christians who revere the image, you will understand what the divine reality truly is. And first you must learn humility." The sheikh awakes in a sweat and immediately sets out on foot from Mecca to Constantinople. And his disciples follow him, wondering what's wrong with the sheikh. And the sheikh finally arrives in Constantinople and looks up and at a balcony sees a beautiful Christian Greek princess. This is an illustration from the early 16th century. This is an illustration to the Central Asian Turkish rendition from the middle 16th century, which shows that the sheikh has looked up and the princess has just drawn aside the curtain which had hidden her features, and he falls into a faint. He is overcome by love, and the painter shows the palace of the Christian princess as if this were the niche of prayer of a mosque, within which, however, burns the eternal flame of the Zoroastrians. There is something very, very strange that is happening here, obviously. In this particular picture from the early 17th century, the sheikh has come to, looking at this palace, which looks like a paradise palace from Isfahan. He looks up at the maiden and says, "I love you. What can I do to prove my love to you?" And she says, "You? You filthy, old, ugly Muslim? You want me to be in love with you?" And he says, "I will do anything you desire. Just give me a command." And she says, "Well, convert to Christianity." "Okay, what do I have to do?" "Well, baptism. Drink wine." "I'll drink wine, I'll drink wine, no problem." "No, but that's not enough," she says. "Well, what more do you want? What more do you want?" "I want you to keep my pigs." That's what she tells him. That's what he does. He dresses as a Christian and he keeps her pigs. The Central Asian artist here, of the middle of the 16th century, didn't know what a domestic pig looked like. They hadn't seen a domestic pig in the area for close to 1,000 years, so he depicts them, of course, as boars. And the disciples are horrified. And yet, when the Christian maiden beholds the humility that the sheikh has shown, she joins him, she falls at his feet, she swoons, she begs to be received into his faith. And then she dies. And he returns to Mecca, having learned that the divine is invisible, as the Jews and Muslims say, but the divine is also visible, as the Christians say. And if you understand both sides of the divine, then you are worthy to be a master, and not before. And it's most significant that this particular episode was painted again and again for Shi'i kings and for some of the most narrowly orthodox Sunni emirs of Uzbekistan in the 16th century. This story circulated from Istanbul to India as a central focus of meditation. We're going to have one more love story, one of the most beautiful. Attar refers to it. It was orchestrated by one of his great contemporaries, Nizami. It's the most famous love story in the East. It describes how a young boy from a certain noble family in school saw one of the schoolgirls raise her veil. Burqa, zey jamal khishba nawsht. She lifted the burqa from her beauty. As soon as he saw her, he became mad with love. His name was Qais. He became Majnun, the mad one. And he dips his stylus into his inkwell to write his first poem of praise of her beauty. And the painter, Behzad, in 1494, has shown her sitting in that portion of the school, which is installed in a mosque. She sits in the very niche of prayer. Mm-hmm. How do we know it's the niche of prayer? Because it says so. Upright is he who prays towards the niche of prayer, meaning, if you would understand the mystery of God, behold the mystery of God manifest in a beautiful woman's countenance from which the veil has been removed. And this should be the focus of your worship. Since this was painted in what is now Afghanistan in 1494 and shows little boys and little girls in the same school, and the girl herself is the focus of worship, as when she takes off her veil, I thought it would be wonderful to project this to audiences in Afghanistan. To amazed reactions. Christian influence? No, this was actually painted right here, 500 years ago. There she is again, the Queen of Heaven, sitting in her niche of prayer. Muhammadi of Iraq painted this. She is the Queen, and she is the Divine, looking at herself, because the Narcissi are symbols of human eyes. And this is a very profound Sufi idea, that the eyes of human beings are the eyes through which God looks upon God, because it is a human being who thinks God. Therefore, God looks on God through human eyes. The young boy was told that he could never marry this girl, that she would be given in marriage to some other family. And so he decided to abandon his family and his wealth, and Behzad shows him here with a great tree of life, renouncing his worldly wealth despite the pleas of his father. And here we have the episode where the young man descends from his horse and exchanges his clothes, princely clothes, for the clothes of a beggar. And now he will become a wandering ascetic. And in the wilderness, he sings poetry of praise to his beloved, and all the animals, tamed by the magic of his words, come to listen. Finally, an old woman has pity on the madman and brings him into the presence of the lady whom he will never be able to touch in this life. The children mock him and call him madman, and he says, yes, I am a madman, because I know that the love for my beloved is love for a reflection and a manifestation of the divine. So this is a very, very famous mystical love story throughout the medieval Islamic world, and I wanted to compare it to the love of he who called himself il pazzoi giocaliere di Dio, the mad one and the jester of the Lord, Saint Francis of Assisi, dedicating himself to holy poverty out of love for my lady faith and my lady hope and my lady charity. Clearly a mystical marriage, highly symbolic. The three figures are also flying towards heaven in this 15th century painting by Saseta. Or here, the resemblance between medieval Christian mysticism and medieval Islamic mysticism is reinforced when we realize that Saint Francis himself in the 13th century considered that his most important mission was to journey to the Islamic lands and convert one of the great sultans. First he tried to go to Morocco, but he fell sick in Spain. Then he finally made his way on a crusader ship to Egypt, and he left the crusader lines at Damietta, and in the year 1219, he was admitted to the presence of Salahuddin's own son, Al-Malik al-Kamil, ruler of Egypt. And here St. Francis is introduced by my beloved lady Faith to the Sultan, and the Sultan thought that he was a very nice madman and just sent him back to crusader lines. But it is very interesting to see that the 13th century Franciscans, in their concern to advocate not war, but peaceful conversion of the Islamic world, sponsored the study of Arabic in Mallorca, and Brother Raymond Lowe, one of the greatest of the 13th century Franciscans, Catalonian, said, among the Saracens are the people whom they call the Sufis, and these tell exempla, stories, which incite the heart to great devotion, which we should learn. These are outward aspects, but you can go much deeper when you talk about archetypes. Saint Francis revered in 13th century Christianity as the living image of Christ, since he received the stigmata. Now, we know that in the mysticism of Attar, 30 birds reach the sunbird. And when 30 birds reach the sunbird, they see no difference between the 30 birds and the sunbird, because the name of the sunbird in Persian can mean 30 birds, Simur. So it's a mystical pun. The 30 souls that have survived the journey are the very image of the divine. Look at the archetype here. Saint Francis, in the 13th century painting here, brushed by the wing of the divine. Saint Francis, the son of a rich family in Assisi, who renounced all his wealth and exchanged his clothes against those of a beggar. Saint Francis, now a monk, preaching to the birds considered symbols of souls. One of the most famous of all episodes of the Franciscan legend is in all these 13th and 14th century paintings by Giotto here, or again. And this image, Saint Francis climbs a great mountain. The mountain here is the link between earth and heaven. He has left behind this lower world, the donkey, symbolizing the body, which is the mount of the soul. It's the water of life, surges from a fount in this mountain, and this traveler drinks, but Saint Francis will go higher. This is the true Mount Sinai, the same symbol as Mount Kaf, the link between earth and heaven. This is what he sees on the summit of Mount Alverno, a great, wonderful sunbird. And when he sees the bird, he receives from the bird the very marks of Christ, meaning in Christian symbolism that Saint Francis has become the mirror of the divine. Since this is Christianity, the divine bird will take on the features of Christ as a seraph. Repetitions of the archetype, this wonderful image by Giotto, showing that sunburst of the divine, transforming St. Francis into the mirror of Christ. Hence, when he dies, searching his wounds. So we will meditate now on the last part of the Canticle of the Birds. Behzad thinks of the tale told of a funeral procession, and here he depicts the graveyard in Herat itself. The funeral procession, and the symbol, the tree which seems to be dead in winter will resurrect in spring, and the soul bird has left the cage of the body. Yet, we should always beware the serpent always trying to catch the soul birds. The book was finished for the Sultan of Herat, represented here, turning his back on his own noble castle, which is compared by the painter Behzad with the wonderful castle mentioned in the Quran. And here, the Christian version, 15th century Christianity, Christ is tempted by Satan with a vision of the kingdom of the earth, the king of France's brother's own wonderful castle, meaning, my lord, you have the most beautiful castle in the world, yet think upon the salvation of your soul. An Indian version from the late 16th century, the king is admitted into the cave with the philosopher. The divine, the devil here, will not be allowed inside, and he's preparing a pot for the souls. And if you look at the sky, you see 30 birds. The birds have finally gathered around the sunbird. The birds fly towards the sunbird. The birds, 30 birds are left. 30, see more. Also, the Quran is divided into 30 parts. The 30 birds have transformed into a mirror of the sunbird. So here we have the detail of the former painting, with the birds flying, and we end with this detail. A 3rd century Egyptian mystic was asked, can you define mysticism in one phrase? And Plotinus answered, it is the flight of the alone to the alone. Unfortunately, yes. Yes. Same sort of prejudice. Absolutely.
It went all the way that far back.
It goes that far back, unfortunately. So what was the... So how did that come about?
Right.
Okay. What was the answer? You have to be used in major spiritual crisis in the 8th century, and in Christian Constantinople and in Islamic Damascus. Both, in both kingdoms, you had people struggling with the idea that we must not represent the divine, and we must banish images altogether. Others maintained, yes, but did not God create man in his own image and breathe life into him? So the people who were opposed to images, known as the iconoclasts, the breakers of icons, triumphed in Constantinople for about 100 years. and they ordered that all icons, images be removed from churches. Nevertheless, they were maintained in the service of the ruler. We see exactly the same thing happening in Damascus, where the caliph orders no images in mosques. However, images are retained in the service of the ruler. So in actual fact, in Islamic civilization, wherever you had flourishing kingdoms, it was considered perfectly appropriate for rulers to be surrounded with paintings. For one thing, I was mentioning this 1001 Nights tradition, the idea was the children of the king are supposed to learn wisdom in instructive books of stories that have been translated from Sanskrit into Persian into Arabic, and so on. These stories were illustrated for the princes better to absorb their meaning. In Constantinople, we know that after 100 years, the iconoduals, the servants of icons, came back into power and restored images in churches, whereas in Islam, the iconoclasts, of course, won permanently, except for the fact that the Sufis were so aware of the tension in their culture between the idea of banning figurative art in mosques and maintaining figurative art in the service of rulers, that in the 14th and 15th centuries, we've seen this revolution occur in which they say some painters are truly holy because they are like the Christ of the Quran, who breathed life into a bird and God said, with my permission. And this idea underlay the extraordinary flourishing of Islamic figurative painting that you get in the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th centuries in countries that correspond today mostly to Turkey, Iran, Afghanistan, Uzbekistan, Pakistan, and northern India. In the 13th century, you also had a lot in Baghdad, in Iraq too. So it's not just non-Arabs, but also very much in Baghdad. So it did exist. For the geometric things that you've seen, you could say that, no, we don't have an image there. You could say, if you look at the decoration in a mosque, you have calligraphy, that means the word of God made visible to human eyes. So the calligraphy of the Quran in a mosque corresponds to the image of Jesus in a church. It is that important. Then you will see the geometric patterns. They are all stylizations of the heavens, star patterns and sunbursts. So what you are looking at is the heavens. You add to that vegetal forms. They are all tendrils of the tree of life. If you have vegetation and you have stars and you bring them together, that means that you are in the gardens of paradise. And a mosque is a prefiguration of the gardens of paradise. And you enter, and if you can, you decipher the inscriptions. So that's the abstract art. And to a great extent, you could say that all Islamic art, from Morocco and Spain all the way to Bengal, varies in the abstract on these three fundamental patterns. But as for figurative art, as you see, it truly did flourish. And it can't simply be brushed away as something that was marginal and out of the way, since these were very costly manuscripts that were copied for sultans. So this is official art. And it's considered to be holy vehicles for philosophical meditation. Any more questions?